Thank you, Yuda. So first of all, it's a pleasure for me to be here. You know, I also to see some familiar faces that I met before, and to get to connect with this community that it's here in Norrköping. So let me tell you a little bit about, you know, what is it that I do, and you know, what are the things that I've been doing recently. So I'm going to focus this presentation mostly on unpublished work, because I thought that's what would be more interesting for you guys. Is on the one hand, to learn what are things that we're doing on top of what we've done, and on the other hand, for me also to try to get your reactions and get your feedback on the work that is now being produced. So at the MIT Media Lab, I run the collective learning group, and the question that we always try to use to focus our research is very simple, is the question of how do teams, cities, and nations learn? And to try to answer this question, I have a group that tries to do two things. On the one hand, you know, we use data to try to understand the collective learning process. So we try to look at the evolution of the industrial structure of regions, the productive structure of countries, or the cultural production that is being produced at places, to try to understand how they get the knowledge that they need to be able to enter these new activities, or to improve their ability to perform these activities. On the other hand, we are also very applied, and we make tools to facilitate collective learning within teams, organizations, and nations. Today in the presentation, I'm going to talk mostly about the first part, you know, which is more based on papers. The second part is more based on projects that get deployed, you know, through the web, and also there's a professionalization effort that we started 5 years ago. But I'm going to also show a little bit about some of those projects, which I think might be interesting to try to see other ways of having impact as researchers, which is not only through our ideas and the knowledge that we create in our publications. So how do we know that a group is learning? And the idea that groups can learn is an old idea in the social sciences. You can go back to Wright in the 1930s, you know, who looked at the output that factories were producing, you know, in terms of the amount of time that it took them to complete a task. In this case, was the production of a plane. And these learning curves have been studied for a long, long time. And they're not the results of a scales economy. It's not that by making more, you produce at lower cost. It's with a fixed amount of inputs, with a fixed amount of labor and capital, you are producing more output per unit of time because that team is learning how to produce a plane. So by accumulating knowledge, it's reducing the cost of production. So during the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s, most of the literature on learning focused on these learning curves and to understand these learning curves, which are like power laws and so forth. You know? But more recently, this literature has focused not only on learning how to do the same task, but learning on how to produce different tasks. So we also know that a group is learning not when they're becoming better at something, but when they're able to do something that they did not know how to do. So for instance, here you see the productive structure of Korea between 1962 and 2015. And you see that in 1962, you know, Korea's exports involved fish, crustaceans and mollusks, iron ore and concentrate, milled rice, raw silk. But then by the mid-80s, they were exporting lots of footwear, shirts, luggage, and different types of garments, ships and boats and cars. And then in the year 2015, it's mostly machinery, mostly electronics. So they were able to change the things that they know how to do. And that's one type of learning. Now, when we look at this learning in this, what trade economists would call extensive margin, you can think of, you know, the word new can mean two different things. It can be new for the world, and that's kind of innovation or invention, you know, or it can be new for the region. So in some sense, cars existed, you know, before Korea started producing cars, but learning how to produce cars was something that was new for Korea. Okay? So it was new for the region, and they must have gathered that knowledge that existed somewhere else somehow. You know? And that's a bit of the mystery that we try to solve. But of course, economists don't only learn how to produce new products, they learn how to develop new research areas, new occupations, new skills, new industries, and whatnot. You know? So how can we test, you know, for learning and for the learning of this second kind? And one way in which we test for learning is we ask the question, are you more likely to succeed when you're close to those that have the knowledge that you don't have? So for instance, you know, I don't know about statistics and I want to learn about statistics. Am I more likely to succeed at learning statistics when I'm surrounded by people that know statistics than when I'm surrounded by people that know about agriculture? You know? And if the answer is yes, I'm more likely to succeed when I'm surrounded by people that have the knowledge that I don't have, means that that knowledge must have flown, you know, on my direction somehow, and therefore I must be learning. So we can test for learning by looking at the probability of success in a new activity, an activity that you didn't perform, increases with the availability of related knowledge. Okay? And I'm going to keep, at the beginning, this very vague, because this idea of relatedness could then be unpacked into many different types of knowledge. And that's something, you know, where the literature, I think, is heading right now. But what it's out there that is already published and has passed peer review is a little bit more aggregate still. You know? So this is the relationship that we want to test. You know, and there are different ways in which we can try to capture relatedness. At a core scale, you know, there's two channels for learning. On the one hand, you can learn from related industries, okay? So you don't have that industry in a location, but there's an industry that is similar in some way, you know? What are the dimensions that determine similarity? I'm going to leave open by now, you know? But those might increase your success. So for instance, you want to learn how to do shirts and there's someone that does pants in the region. Does that increase your probability of being successful at producing shirts? The other way is that knowledge can diffuse geographically. So you might not know how to produce shirts, but there's a neighbor that knows how to produce shirts. Thus, having a neighbor that knows how to produce shirts increases the probability that you would succeed. In that case, you would be sucking the knowledge from the neighbor. In that case, you would be sucking the knowledge locally from a related activity. No? And to test these ideas, you know, one, of course, has to draw networks that help us identify what are things that are related. So one network of this type is the product space, which we published in 2007. And here, each dot represents a product, and products are connected, and the probability of co-exporting them is large. So that's how we map relatedness in a way that is agnostic also about the mechanisms that drive relatedness. So we don't know if relatedness is the result of input-output relationships, shared knowledge, labor flows, whatever it is. You know, we're saying if relatedness exists, you know, these products are more likely to be produced in the same place. Okay? And there in the green side, you have all of the garments, you know, so shirts, pants, socks, underwear are all there. In the light blue center, you have machinery. On the right side, you have cars and car parts, you know, like engines and chassis and buses, and you have also wheels and, you know, transmissions and so forth. On the left side of the machinery cluster, you have kind of like the machines that make the machines. These are the most sophisticated stuff, the ones that you would buy in a factory. Like when you go to a car factory, I don't know if you guys have been to a car factory, and you see this big machine that says Komatsu on top, and poof, it prints a chassis out of like a piece of steel. Those really specialized machines are there on the left. Then on the top left there in the light blue, you have electronics, you know. On the purple, you have chemicals and so forth, you know. And we know which products are related because they're co-exported, so we can look if the probability of entering an export market increases with the number of related activities. So here we look at Chile in 1979. The products that Chile exports are painted. The ones that they don't are grayed out. And we see that Chile in 1979 is concentrated there on the top right, where they don't export fresh fish, but they export a bunch of related products like frozen fish, crustaceans, and mollusks, and so forth. Chile also doesn't export vegetables, you know, but export related products, you know. So the question is, if we go to the future of 1979, which is something like 1996, did Chile enter those related activities? And the answer is yes, you know, they were more likely to enter activities that were related to the ones that they were already producing. So if we go back to our curve, you know, we can now draw it empirically, and we see that the probability of entering a new activity in a four-year period increases with the number of related activities that Chile was already exporting. Now let's look at not an international trade data example, but a local data example. So here we're going to use data for China from 1990 to 2015. This is data summarizing the number of publicly traded firms that are present in each province. Okay, so we're looking at provincial level data. This is still, you know, very aggregate because the largest provinces in China have more than 100 million people. So they're very large. Okay, there are only 30 provinces in China, around 32. And here you have the industry space of China. So here two industries are connected if they are located in the same province with high probability. On the left you have manufacturing. On the right cluster you have IT, finance, like the advanced service sector. On the periphery you tend to have agriculture, mining, you know, the usual suspects that are in the periphery. And you can see how different Chinese provinces diversified over time. So for example, you see Hebei, you know, diversifies on that pink manufacturing cluster, is entering all of those activities, in this case shown in white. Now, if we look at the probability that a province would enter an industry in 5 years, it also increases with the number of related activities. You know, so we reproduce the same effect that we found in the product data. But here we can also look at whether the probability that you would enter, you know, an industry increases with the number of neighboring provinces that are already active in that industry. You know? And when we do that, we find that actually having neighbors that are good in an industry increases the probability that you will enter that industry in the future. So there appears to be some geographic diffusion of knowledge as well. Now the next question that we ask now that we have like these two channels is like, well, what happens if you're a province that has a lot of related industries and has a lot of neighbors that have that industry already there? Do you become a super learner? You know, do these effects when I put an interaction term, you know, have a positive interaction, or do they exhibit diminishing returns? You know, so when I have one, I don't need the other one. And what we find is actually that you have diminishing returns. So what limits learning appears to be, you know, the lack of one learning opportunity. If you have related industries, you know, like which would be like the marginal that you will observe here on the left, you know, if you have no related industries, no active neighboring provinces, of course you don't have a high probability of entering that activity. But if you have more related industries, that probability increases. If you have more neighboring provinces, that probability increases. But once you have turned on one of the two channels, the second channel doesn't add any marginal effect. So when I put them in the regression, you know, they're both positive, but when I put the interaction term basically cancels the other two because they're diminishing returns. So you don't become a super learner, you know, when you have, you know, the local related industries and the neighbors that are good at the industry. You know, these two effects kind of cancel out because what you need is to have at least one of them. You know? One thing that has been hard to do in this literature is to try to address the famous endogeneity problem. Luckily, we're not in a room full of economists, you know. So in this paper, we try to address the endogeneity problem with an instrumental variable. It's not a perfect instrumental variable, but given the lack of instrumental variables in this area of research, we think the exercise is still valuable. And that instrumental variable is the introduction of high-speed rail. So during the last 2 decades, China introduced a lot of high-speed rail. This high-speed rail was introduced over pre-existing rail lines, you know, and it was quite political. So for example, there's a rail line that goes all the way to the far west in China where very few people live, and that's because China, of course, wants to be connected not only for economic reasons, but for political reasons. You know? So we can assume that in some way this might be a little bit exogenous, you know, to the industrial structure of some of the provinces that are connected. And the question that we ask ourselves to test, you know, whether the introduction of high-speed rail was able to improve learning is to see if the provinces that were connected by rail had an increase in productivity in the industries that they shared that was larger than the increase in productivity that the industries that they did not share. That's a little bit complicated, so let me unpack it a little bit. So let's say you have Tianjin and Beijing, okay? And you connect these two provinces by rail. Now there's some industries that are present in both, okay? In Tianjin and Beijing. So let's say they both produce shoes, okay? Now, if there is learning taking place, what you would expect is that, you know, the productivity of the shoe industry should go high, should go up, because now there's more chances of learning given that the travel time got reduced. Yeah? So these provinces now are in some way physically closer by the interaction of rail. But there are some industries that are present in one and not the other. So the ones that are present in one and not the other exhibit a shock of productivity because of the rail, but they don't exhibit a shock because of learning, because they have nobody to learn more from, because they're not connected to someone else that also had the same industry. So we can compare the increase in productivity of the ones that are shared with the ones that were only in one and not the other. And what we find is that, of course, you know, China is super productive. So as, you know, the rail is introduced, the productivity of all industries go up, but the industries that were present in both of the provinces that were connected by rail goes up faster. How much faster? 98,000 yuan a year. This is labor productivity, which is revenue per worker. This is like $15,000, you know, of revenue per worker more, you know, if you share those provinces. We also look at whether the provinces that were connected by rail became more similar in terms of the industry that they had, and we also find that they become more similar. And this is kind of interesting because it might seem obvious because I'm giving you the answer, but it's not so obvious if you interpret this through the light of traditional trade theory. Because traditional trade theory tells you that if you put a train between two cities, now competition is going to go up and the cities are going to specialize and they're going to become more different. And what we find is that they become more similar and that the productivity of the industries that are shared is the one that goes up. So apparently there is a force that is counterbalancing the force of competition, which is this force of learning, and in this case, in the case of China, tends to be overwhelming. Okay, so we know that the probability that a region will succeed in the export of a new product or in developing a new industry increases with the number of related activities. Okay? But the question, is this effect more general? You know? Or is it just true for China and for the export data I showed you? What are the things that actually drive it? What is flowing or why is this relatedness important? Does it matter? And what are the optimal strategies that we should follow? So to answer the first question, actually this is quite general. And with a number of co-authors now, we have a paper under submission in which we claim that there's a principle here, which we call the principle of relatedness, and I call the first law of relatedness, which is the law of entry. And this is that the probability of entering economic activity, a product, industry, research area, etc., increases with the presence of related knowledge. And this is true across geographic scales, so you can do it at the level of countries or at the level of cities. It's true for different types of activities, industries, research areas, patents, products, so forth. And it's true for different institutional regimes. No, it's true in Saudi Arabia, it's true in China, it's true in Sweden, it's true in Brazil, it's true in the United States. No? So we know that it's true for products, we know that it's true for industries in different institutional regimes, you know, and also with very different data sets. Here, the data for Brazil is social security data, you know. The data for Sweden is this plant level data that Frank and Ron got. And the data for China, you know, is data on publicly traded firms, you know, from the stock exchange. And in all the three examples, we observe basically the same behavior, you know. So it's interesting that also this is robust across data sets that you could say they have very different biases, you know. Yeah. It's true for research areas, so the probability that an individual, a university, or a country would enter a research area also increases with the number of research areas that they're active in. And it's true also for patents, okay? So the probability that you will start patenting in a certain technology class increases with the number of related technology classes in which you already patent. There's a second law, you know, which is this law of exit, which also tells you that the probability that you will exit, you know, a region decreases with the number of related activities that are present in that region. Okay? So this is an interesting law because it basically tells you that there's a lot of industrial policy that happened in the past that is very wrong. You know, in Brazil there is a lot of industrial policy that did happen in the 60s and 70s that thought that you build a big plant in a small city and then that big plant is going to generate spillovers that are going to help develop that region. And it's not only Brazil that has attempted to do that, that they do kind of like this one big project, expecting the spillovers to happen. But those one big projects, of course, are placed in places that have no related activities. So these islands, you know, actually have a high probability of exit, you know, because of the lack of relatedness, you know, that as we later see depends on the availability of knowledge, you know. So it tells you that at the end of the day, you want to put, you know, that activity in a place that has all of these related activities if you want it to survive, you know, at least for a long run. Now, just, you know, because this is going to get confusing in a few minutes, here we're talking about a region exiting an industry. But when a region is in an industry, it might mean that many firms are operating in that industry. So this is a law only about that region exiting that industry. Then we're going to see effects about firms, you know, because when a region exits an industry, is that all firms exited, or the majority of them did, but a region might be entering an industry in a process also that many firms enter and a few survive, you know? And that differential survival of firms is not the same as the differential survival of regions, okay? And I'm calling attention to that because next we're gonna be looking at that. So we know who enters, we know who exits, but among those who enter, we wanna know who are the ones that survive. And luckily, we have a data set, you know, that we collected from Brazil between the year 2013 and onwards to create this project called Data Viva, which is a tool that makes available data on the entire formal sector economy of Brazil, data between 2003 and 2013. The project was released in 2013 and then updated in 2015, you know. And this is very rich data because it's data at the individual level. So for every person in Brazil, we have their work history for 10 years. So we know for each person, the firm that they work in, you know, we actually know the establishment that they work in, and we know how that establishment is connected to the main firm, the industry in which they're operating in, the occupation, you know, that they're doing, the region in which they're operating in, like the municipality that they're in, and also we know a lot about their demographics, okay? So it's a very rich data set it's also a data set that has a very strong incentive to be comprehensive, because it's the data set that Brazil was using to provide the Bolsa Familia, which is a famous conditional cash transfer program, you know. So if you were not in that data set, you could not get, you know, the subsidy, and therefore there was a big incentive for this data set to be very, you know, comprehensive, you know. So we have the work history of every person in Brazil, and also, of course, of every firm in Brazil, you know? And we can see the new industries that enter allocation, okay. So we can see, for example, that an industry enters a region where that industry was not present, but we can see what are all of the firms that participated of that entry event, okay. So let's say you have a region that didn't have that industry, and now three firms enter, you know. And of course, we can see if the probability of entering increases with relatedness, you know. So to make sure that this law of relatedness that we saw before also works here, and it works charmingly. And we divide here between pioneers. Pioneers are firms that enter a region and did not exist anymore. It's like a completely new firm. Okay. So the entry event was one that involved like a new firm. Pivots are firms that existed in the region but changed the industry that they're operating in. Regional branches, you know, are firms that existed in another region and then open an establishment in that region. So for example, when McDonald's enters a region, you know, and there's an entry event for fast food restaurants, that's, you know, a regional branching event. And local branches would be, there is a firm operating in that region that opens an establishment that operates in another industry. And in all cases, we find that the, you know, relatedness among industries, the relatedness among regions matters, and that the interaction effect is negative. In this case, you know, it's not significant, but in most cases it is, meaning that there is this diminishing returns that we observed before. But now the question that we ask here is who survives, you know? And the reason why we're asking this question is because this is going to allow us to differentiate between three different types of knowledge. Okay, because we know that relatedness matters, but we don't know what the heck is driving relatedness. So when you start a new firm, you can say that, and you hire people, that people comes in with knowledge, but comes with different types of knowledge. For example, some of these people might have worked in the same industry or in a related industry. And we're going to say that if that's the case, these people come with industry-specific knowledge. So for instance, I open a shoe factory, you know, and I hire someone that worked on, you know, like a belt factory. This is a related industry. Yeah? In that case, that person is going to bring industry-specific knowledge. But that person might be doing the same occupation or a different occupation. Okay? So also I can see, well, the people that I'm hiring, are they performing in this firm the same occupation that they performed in the previous firm that they worked in? And in that case, I'm going to say it's occupation-specific knowledge. Okay? Because the person might switch occupations as they move from one industry to another, or they might be performing the same occupation and be changing between wildly different industries. So I might have been an accountant in a hospital and I'm an accountant in a hotel. Those industries are very different, but the occupation in that case would be the same. Now, is this person one that was working locally there or comes from a faraway region? If it's local, you might say that it has local knowledge, you know, might have knowledge about the market, might have contacts, might have a network, and so forth. And then the last part, which I don't have in the regression table that we have here, but Christian does have a regression table with that, is, well, the knowledge that comes from formal education. So we know how many years of schooling, what's the highest degree achieved by each one of these people, so we can control for that as well. So here we look at the survival of each one of these firms at the third year. So just to give you an idea of what is the sample that we're looking at all regions that entered an industry that was not present in that region, okay? So these are micro-regions in Brazil, so they're relatively small, you know, but the nice thing about micro-regions is that when you do municipalities, large cities might have multiple municipalities, but micro-regions tend to group all of those metro areas into, you know, single entities, which makes more sense, I think, from an economic perspective. You know? And we look at all of the firms that entered, you know, in a region where that industry was not present, and we look at the different forms of relatedness. And what's interesting is the following, is that first, but for the survival at the third year, we find that the relatedness that matter for predicting the entry and the exit of the region does not matter anymore. Okay? So that's kind of funny because, you know, we know that the probability of entering increases with relatedness, but the probability that a firm would survive does not depend on relatedness. So is that a puzzle? Well, and the reason is that, of course, there were more entry events in the places that had higher density. So this already cannot explain who in that place survived. So for example, there was a lot of relatedness in Campinas, you know, for let's say computer science type of activities, you know? And now that a lot of firms enter, the relatedness in Campinas doesn't matter anymore. You know, it mattered for entering, but among those firms, you know, the ones that they are in regions of high relatedness are not the ones that necessarily tend to survive. This is the number of workers that they had when the firm got started, which is a way to kind of like control for the total initial capital. So if you started a startup with one person, you started with 20 people, might mean that when you had only one person, you had really no capital, so it's just an entrepreneur. When you had 20, you might have had money to start, you know, investing. And then these are like the different type of knowledge that we care about. So this is the industry relatedness of the workforce. So did you hire people that worked in the same industry before or in a related industry before? Okay? And that is always highly significant. You see, it's like 10 times their standard errors, you know, more or less. You know, and it doesn't get knocked out with the controls. You know, this is the occupation-specific knowledge. So are the people performing the same occupation or a related occupation? Here, a related occupation depends on knowledge flows, sorry, on labor flows. So that people that work on one occupation tend to flow to that occupation. That's how we know that they're related. And if you put it by itself, it matters. But once you put the industry-specific knowledge into it, it actually reverses the sign. You know, it flips over. You know, so in some way, you know, this matters because, of course, you might have been performing the same occupation at a related industry. But once you control for whether the people come with industry-related knowledge, the occupation-specific knowledge doesn't appear, you know, to matter. Actually, you know, it's almost insignificant and it tends to be negative. And this is the local knowledge. Where are these people coming from? The same region or from a different region? And you find that when they come from the same region, survival is higher. So what this is telling you is actually that industry-specific knowledge appears to matter and local knowledge appears to matter, but occupation-specific knowledge does not appear to matter. Yeah?
Survival, yeah.
You know, on the other hand, you know, it does start telling us things that are kind of weird because the educational system that we have tends to prepare people for occupation instead of industries, if you think about it. You know, you go to study accounting, or you go to study to be an architect, you know, you go to study an occupation, but you don't go to study to be in the tech sector, or you don't go to study to be in a certain, you know, sector in particular, that despite, you know, the occupation that you're going to be doing in that sector. You know, and what this is telling us is that at the end of the day, you know, that industry-specific knowledge matters more than the occupation-specific knowledge, and there's other pieces of evidence that are telling us that that might be the case too. So there is another study, I forgot right now the name of the authors, but that look at people, career trajectory, and they look at the salaries of people that stay in the same industry and switch occupations, okay? So like the old story that you would hear of like the person that entered the bank as a teller, and you know, at the end of their life they were like the, you know, depressing like that, like grandpa story, you know? But that type of trajectory, you know, that they stay in the same industry and they did different occupations along the, and people that stuck to the same occupation and switch industries. And over the lifetime, the people that stick to the same industry end up making more money than the ones that stick to the same occupation and switch industries. You know? So the market might be paying for that industry-specific knowledge. That's another, you know, reason to believe that this industry-specific knowledge appears to matter a lot. Another reason is that, you know, have you ever tried to go into the private sector? You know, like one of the things that postdocs face when they try to enter the private sector is, what are the private sector companies asking for? They don't ask. You might have great publications, you might be super smart, everything. They're gonna ask you for industry experience, you know? And they're really, really adamant at that. And breaking into the private sector at the beginning when you're coming out of academia is really hard because of that lack of industry experience, because they really value that, you know, to having worked on that industry. So in that context, that is also another signal that the market is, you know, like giving a premium for this. And of course, industries have associations where they try to train their workers and so forth in that specific industry. So that's also something that I think is interesting coming out from here, that is telling us that in some way the way that we're thinking about knowledge and teaching in the context of economics might be a little bit mistaken by focusing too much, you know, on the occupations and the skills and too little on the industry, because there's a lot of industry-specific knowledge that at this moment I think is very informal in the way that we're learning it, you know? And there might be some efforts to maybe formalize that if we want to increase the success of our firms. Yeah. So I would claim this is, you know, this is a stretch because the other ones, the law of entry, the law of exit, are very well documented. But I'm going to conjecture here that the probability of film survival does not depend on the presence of relatedness, but on hiring those with related knowledge, especially industry-specific and local knowledge. So the presence of related knowledge increases the probability that you enter and decreases the probability that you exit, but the probability that a firm would survive does not depend on that knowledge just being in the air, okay? So these externalities do not flow through the air. So you don't open a window and externality flows from one firm to another firm. You know, you have to actually hire the people that have that knowledge. So this knowledge is flowing as you're hiring the people that comes with this industry-specific knowledge and with this local knowledge. So you might go to Silicon Valley, where there's a lot of related knowledge on how to develop, you know, software and hardware, but if you hire a bunch of people that don't have that related knowledge and they just live in the valley doing other things, you are not gonna access any of the benefits of that local relatedness, okay? So that's ultimately what determines, you know, the survival of firms. Now, we have looked mostly at knowledge diffusion in the context of what we make, okay? So this is entering into new activity, entering into a new industry, entering into the export of a new product. But does it also determine whom do we trade with? You know? So that's a different part of, you know, the economic activity. On the one hand, we have to figure out what to make. On the other hand, we have to figure out who we can sell it to. Okay? You know, and this whom we can sell it to, traditionally, you know, has been thought of through, you know, like commerce, which is in some way, you know, where economics got started. You know, if you think about like before Adam Smith, you know, Josiah Child treatise all in commerce, and you know, like commerce was the big part of economics early on, you know. But traditional trade theory assumes that trade in some sense is an equilibrium process, you know, that depends on differences in factor endowments, that's the old traditional trade theory, in product varieties, that's much newer, you know, and firm productivities, transportation costs, and so forth. So in some way, you know, that firms that produce different products, because maybe they're in places that have different factor endowments, or there are different varieties of the product that they can produce, or they're differing productivity, or there are different transportation costs that allows them to accept customers, and the system goes into some sort of equilibrium in which, you know, the firms that survive or the trade links that survive are the ones that are optimal given, you know, these boundary conditions. Okay? But in the recent years, there have been two contributions to trade theory that I think, you know, are very complementary to this work, because this is not that this is wrong, but this is incomplete. And the first one is that trade actually is shaped a lot by information frictions. So if two countries share a language, they have much higher trade flows than if they don't, controlling for distance, controlling for transportation costs, controlling for factor endowments and all of them. If they share borders also, if they share a colonial past, you know, etc. So all of these things that facilitate the ability of people to communicate, you know, have a measurable positive effect on trade. You know? So this is all relatively recent, you know, but this idea that information frictions shape trade. The other one is that countries and regions need to learn how to produce the products they trade. Okay? So if we put these two together, we can say, well, do countries and regions also need to learn how to trade each product to each destination? So if I know how to export wine, do I know how to export wine to Switzerland and to China, and is learning how to export wine to Switzerland the same as learning how to export wine to China? And it might not be, you know? And if it's not the same, then I have to learn, you know, how to trade each product with each destination. So we look here at three forms of relatedness. The first one is product relatedness. So let's say Korea exports product 1 and product 2 to Chile, and there's a related product, product 3. Thus, exporting product 1 and product 2 to Chile increases the probability that Korea will start exporting product 3, or that increases the volume of exports of product 3. So let's say Korea exports, you know, cell phones and LCDs. Does it increase the probability that it starts, you know, exporting car stereos, whatever, you know, to Chile, another related product? You know? So in this case, the relatedness would be among products, you know, among industries. Then there is this importer relatedness. Let's say Korea is exporting product 1 to Peru and to Argentina. But Peru and Argentina are geographic neighbors of Chile. They also share a language with Chile, they share a border with Chile, they share a colonial past with Chile. Does that increase the probability that Korea would enter the Chilean market? Okay? So in this case would be some relationship between the importers. It's the same product, the same exported, but between the importers there might be some relationship. Now, we don't know where the learning is happening. It might be that Korean exporters are learning how to export to a related industry, or that Chilean importers are learning how to import, you know, by learning from the neighbors. The next one will be among exporters. So let's say China and Japan export product one to Chile. Does that increase the probability that Korea, which is a neighbor of China and Japan, export product one to Chile? Okay? So we set up a big gravity model, okay? And we look at the trade in 2 year time, controlling, you know, by the volume of trade in this year. So we look at like basically the increasing trade, and we also control for the total exports of a country in a product and the total imports of a country in that product. So in some way, you know, we take into account all of that, like bulk flow there. You know? And here we look at these three forms of relatedness. So the first one is that product relatedness, and we divide into three periods: pre-crisis, during crisis, after crisis. Honestly, the facts and the stars are the same, so I'm going to just discuss them, you know, as if it were one thing. And what we find is that the product relatedness tends to matter actually quite a bit. You know, so if you export a product, the flow of related products to that country is going to increase much more than that of unrelated products. Then, if you have relatedness among importers, so if your neighbor is importing a product, they're more likely to increase, you know. And if your neighbor is exporting a product, you are also more likely to increase, you know, those exports. Now, these three coefficients are standardized, okay? So these are units of one standard deviation, and since that is doing on one standard deviation, we can compare them. And the product relatedness tends to be, you know, much stronger in its effect than the relationship among the importers, you know, or the relationship among geographic neighbors. Then we also find, of course, you know, these are things that were known. One is that sharing a border, you know, increases, you know, the trade flow of that product, having shared a colonial past as well, you know, and having shared, you know, sharing a language also, you know, increases the trade flows. And this is a regression not of total trade flow, is country, product, destination. Okay, so this hasn't been done at this type of specificity before. And then finally here we have this language proximity. You know, this is the number of books translated from one language to another language. To try to capture, you know, for example, if you think about it, let's say Arabic and French are very different languages, but they are connected because, you know, there's a lot of flow, you know, of information and people that speak both languages. Yeah, you know, but maybe, you know, French is not so connected to Russian because there's not so many people that speak both French and Russian comparatively. You know? And we find that, except for in the last case, you know, this language proximity matters, of course, not as much as sharing the language, but the number of mutual translations appear to matter. So these three forms of relatedness tell us, hey, we might be getting better at exporting a specific product to a destination, you know, if we export related things, if one of our neighbors exports to it, or if we're already exporting to one of the neighbors. Now, is this true, you know, for new exporters, for nascent exporters, for experienced exporters? You know, when you're looking, for example, at German exporting cars, it's very different than when you look at when South Africa was entering the car export. Yeah? Germany is a very experienced car. Like Germany exporting printing presses. They have been exporting printing presses for 500 years, you know? So, and Germany is still the number one exporter of printing presses, which is a nice factor to show how stable knowledge, you know, a competitive advantage can be in some cases. You know? They have like 45-50% of the printing press market. Yeah. And if you look at new exporters, you know, you find that the R-square is much smaller. Of course, there are differences in the sample size, so you have to take this a pinch of salt, but the differences in R-square are huge also, you know. So that are likely to be due just because of difference in sample size. So when you are in new exporters, you have a small R-square. Basically, it's a lot of uncertainty. Yeah. And in those cases that there's a lot of uncertainty, actually, you know, the relatedness among products, the relatedness among importers, the relatedness among exporters tend to be a little bit, and actually quite a bit stronger than in the case of more experienced, you know, exporters. Now, when you're looking at experienced exporters, these are countries that had comparative advantage in that product at the global level, and you're looking at how they're increasing their exports to a particular destination, that's where it's much higher, meaning that the relationship is much more predictable by, you know, what we knew previously, especially like, of course, the previous trade flows and so forth. You know? So it's much more regular, and you know, in turn also the importance of relatedness is a little bit smaller, you know, in these two cases. Yeah? But the relationship much more certain, much more predictive. You know? Finally, we divide this into products of different levels of sophistication. So we use large classification, and we separate products into primary products, resource-based manufacturers, low-tech manufacturers, medium-tech manufacturers, high-tech manufacturers. And we do this because the idea here, you know, which is an idea that has been in the literature before, is that if you are going to export a more sophisticated product, knowledge flows are going to matter more. Yeah? So if you want to export oil or you want to export copper, you know, you basically have to get it out of the ground, but there's an international market for that. So to sell, you know, copper to another country, you don't need to know the people, establish a commercial relationship and so forth. You know, so in some sense, for these primary products, you know, this effect should not matter that much, you know? But when you're doing a high-tech product, this effect should matter more. You know, because in that case, when you're selling a specific, differentiated, sophisticated product, you really need, you know, to basically reduce all of these information asymmetries that you have to reduce to be able to establish that commercial relationship, which is going to be much more specific. It might be a commercial relationship between a manufacturer and a distributor and a retailer in that country. It's not something that happens through like a market and a clearing house. So we, since there's a lot of stars and shit on that regression, we basically look at the relationships that are significant if we look at the trend over the primary resource, low tech, medium, high tech. So these are the coefficients, the typo there. You know? And for example, the product relatedness coefficient, you know, is significant. So if you export primary products, you know, relatedness matters way less than if you export high tech products, and this slope, you know, is statistically significant. But for the other two forms of relatedness, the slope is not significant. Okay? Now, when we look at the other challenge, like sharing the same language also matters a lot, but sharing the border doesn't appear, you know, to have an effect for different levels of sophistication. Okay? So learning is affected by technological sophistication, you know, but the learning challenges that appear to matter with the technological sophistication are the strongest ones, which are language and this product relatedness, not the other regional challenges.